Hello everyone, I'm Nicolas Trezan, also known as Coolcat VFX. Welcome back to the second part of the preview video of the Ablaze course. This time, you're going to apply the theory learned in the last video about UVs and UV distortion to animate this static flame through your own shader. If you want to grab the course, it's accessible on P2design Academy, so check out the description for more details. And with that said, enjoy the video! Time to get the job done. We're gonna make this UV distortion shader works. Don't worry about the flame texture itself. It's already made and ready to use. You just have to focus on making the shader, its material, and assigning it to the Niagara particle system. Now, let's navigate to the shader folder, the folder where we will create our material. Our objective is to create a shader that incorporates UV distortion, handles transparency using the Alpha Blend blending mode, and combines the color of the RGB channels of the texture multiplied to the Niagara system particle color. This might ring a bell for you, as it follows a similar pattern, doesn't it? You've probably already guessed our next move. To save valuable production time, we will duplicate the previously created Alpha Blend shader and make the necessary adjustments to meet our requirements. Oh, and don't forget to rename it correctly, following the naming convention document guidelines. Let's break down the shader creation process, step by step. Firstly, we need to make a small adjustment to how the shader handles colors. As said previously, for this shader, we don't want the particle system's particle color to be the sole factor in determining the texture's color. Instead, we want the RGB values of the texture itself to influence the final color. This will create variations in emissive intensity within the texture, with lighter and darker parts. Next, we'll incorporate the UV distortion feature into the shader by implementing a scrolling noise texture. And finally, the final touch to the UV distortion setup will be the use of the green channel of the texture coordinates node as a gradient mask. By doing so, we can reduce the UV distortion effect at the base of the flame. This adjustment ensures that the flame's distortion is not uniform across its entire surface, as flames typically flicker more intensely at their tip compared to their base. So first up, let's edit the color setup of the shader. To make our texture's color controlled by the particle system's particle color and the texture RGB values, we simply have to add a multiply node and multiply together the RGB output of the texture node and the RGB output of the particle color node, with the result linked to the emissive input of the master node. Now, for the UV distortion part. To achieve the desired effect, we'll need to address the following requirements. Create a texture sampler node to cause the noise texture in the shader. Implement movement for the noise texture. And control its styling, scrolling speed, and intensity. Let's begin with the texture sampler node setup. Add a texture sample node and assign a default texture to it. Since we'll need to modify this texture later in the material, let's make it a customizable parameter. Next, we'll work on making the texture move. We can achieve this by using a panel node, especially thanks to the speed input of this node. Instead of uniformly scaling the noise texture and scrolling it at the same speed on both the vertical and horizontal axis, we'll introduce non-uniform scaling. By squashing the noise texture along one axis, we can enhance, for example, the vertical flow direction for a distortion effect. This will give the illusion of the flame distorting predominantly in the vertical direction. To enable independent scaling of the noise texture on the horizontal and vertical axes, we'll need four channels to control the scaling and speed of the texture on each axis individually. These axes being X and Y for both the scaling and scrolling speed of the texture. We can use a vector 4 and turn it into two vector 2s. We will need to edit these values later on. So turn this constant 4 vector into a parameter with a name like noise texture tiling and scrolling speed. The two first channels will control the texture tiling on the X and Y axes, while the last two channels will control the scrolling speed on the X and Y axes. As you can see, we can only connect a vector to the speed and coordinate input of the panel node. To make a vector out of these separated channels, we'll fuse them together by using two append nodes. We'll transform these individual channels into vector 2s. For these vectors, we'll have both two channels each. To adjust the texture styling, multiply the first vector 2 to a texture coordinate node linked to the coordinate input of the panel node. Multiplying the vector 2 by the texture coordinate values will allow us to control the tiling of the texture. A value of 1 will represent 100% of the size of the texture on the desired axis. So values greater than 1 will result in texture repetition. For the scrolling speed, the vector 2 we created will act as a speed value. Connect the append node to the speed input of the panel node. And the higher the value, the faster the texture will scroll on the desired axis. You can finally connect the panel node output to the UV's input of the texture sample node. You might want to see what's going on with the texture right now. So right-click on the texture sample node and select Start Previewing node while selecting the plain 3D mesh in the preview window. By default, you won't see anything because the vector 4 values for tiling and scrolling speed are all set to 0. To visualize the texture properly and confirm that everything is functioning correctly, I recommend making the following adjustments. Set both tiling channels to a value of 1. Choose a value of 0.1 for one of the scrolling speed channels. By incorporating negative values, you can also flip the texture horizontally or vertically and enable scrolling in the opposite direction. Making the right adjustments to tiling and scrolling speed values will be something we'll do when we'll create some material out of the shader later on. As you can see, the noise texture is finally moving. We can now stop previewing the node by right-clicking on it and click on Set Option. And the final touch to this node setup will be to control the intensity of the noise texture, or how strongly it will distort the UV of the flame texture. For that, just multiply the RGB input of the texture sample to a constant that you will turn into a parameter and rename it noise intensity. Usually, for this kind of effect, a value around 0.2 is enough to make the texture dense without being too much. We don't want to ruin the initial look of the texture. Now that we can successfully control the noise texture styling, scrolling speed, and intensity, we need to introduce intensity variations in the distortion feature to simulate a more intense flickering of the flame at its tip compared to its base. To achieve this effect, we'll use the vertical mask obtained from the green channel of the texture coordinate node. By multiplying this mask with our distortion effect, we can control the intensity of the distortion across the texture. Values near the bottom and darker part of the gradient will be reduced to nearly zero, resulting in minimal distortion. On the other end, values near the top and lighter parts of the gradient will apply the full distortion effect, accordingly to the intensity value of the distortion, of course. Add a texture coordinate node and connect it to a component mask node. This node will receive and output a vector while allowing us to indicate which channels from said vector we want to keep. You can think of it like a channel filter if you want. While you got the node selected, ensure that only the green channel passes through. This will transform our UV text code vector 2 with the red and green channels to a simple vector with only one channel. The gradient won't have the correct orientation. We need it to start dark at the bottom and be bright at the top. To achieve this, use a 1-minus node. This node inverses the input value and outputs 1-minus that value, effectively reversing the gradient in our case. Now, you can multiply the reversed vertical gradient with a UV distortion setup. Finally, we need to apply the entire distortion effect, including the mask, to the flame texture. To do this, add the result of the multiply node to a texture coordinate node and link it to the flame texture sample. You might have an error here concerning a conflict of input types. That's because we are using the RGB output of the noise texture sampler node, a vector 3, as a data to feed into the UV's input of the texture sample node that needs a vector 2 data only. To fix this problem, we need to make sure the vector we are plugging in the texture sample node is a vector 2, or a float 2, as it is written here. And for that, we'll once again use the component mask node right after the second multiply with the R and G channels selected. And we are done with the shader creation. Don't forget to save your work. Now, we need to configure the multiple parameters of the shader, such as the noise texture styling and intensity. In the content browser window, select your shader and create a material out of it. In the material window, we'll first tick all parameters because we will edit all of them. Once it is done, assign the right texture in the noise texture and base texture slot. Then, we want to set the intensity of the noise texture to something around 0.3 to have a noticeable distortion effect. Now, we only have to play around with the noise texture styling and scrolling speed. Personally, I went for a styling of 1 on X and 0.5 on Y to have some stretching applied on the noise texture to accentuate the vertical flow of the distortion effect. And for the speed, I went for a value of 0.4 on the y-axis to make it scroll to the top at a good speed. Now that the material is set up, it's time to put it in the Niagara particle system. Go to the practical exercise scene, locate and focus on the fx_ns_uv_distortion particle system. Open it by double-clicking on the Niagara system asset in the detail window. And in the sprite renderer module, assign your material by entering its name in the search bar. And voila! You've successfully created and implemented a UV distortion shader in Unreal Engine 5. Great job! If you're looking to enhance this shader further, there's an interesting technique you can try. Consider incorporating two or three noise textures with varying scales and scrolling speeds. This will add complexity to the distortion effect, creating multiple layers of movement. If you are up for experimenting, simply duplicate the UV distortion node setup and add it to the original one, just before applying the gradient mask. This will give you the desired result. As we reach the end of this chapter, there is one final exciting exercise waiting for us. We'll leave the world of VFX for a couple of videos to delve into the world of tech art to work on an intriguing exercise, creating an animated outline shader using the remarkable Fresnel feature. Now, I must admit, the shader technique may appear complex, but there is no need to worry. Just like we have done so far, we take our time to explain the core concept of Fresnel and what it can do. So, let's meet in the next video, where we'll explore this fascinating shader feature together. Bye! And that's it! I hope you enjoyed the content of the preview videos of the course. There's plenty more content awaiting you in the Ablaze course, so if you want to know more about it, check out the description below. And I see you soon, folks. Bye-bye!